Mrs. Caldwell?
Here.
Mr. Colella?
Here.
Mr. Dowdell is absent. Mrs. Gallagher is absent.
Nope, she's on the phone.
Oops. Oh, okay, I apologize. Mrs. Rossler?
Here.
Mr. Rogers?
Here.
Mr. Schlock?
Here.
Mrs. Stepnick?
Here.
And Mr. Zuko?
Here.
Thank you.
Thank you. The board met in executive session on January 10th, January 17th, and this evening, the 31st, to discuss matters of student confidentiality, personnel, negotiations, and real estate.
Excuse me, Mr. President, there was one other additional item, tax sales.
Okay, excuse me. Taxes.
Approval of minutes, recommend approval of the following meeting minutes, January 20, regular board meeting, January 17th, discussion meeting.
Thank you.
I just have a, do you want to make a recommendation first, though?
That's okay, go ahead.
I just want to make a comment. I was here at the Committee of the Whole on the 17th, and if the minutes could reflect that I left towards the very end of the meeting. They currently state that I left during the meeting. I was there for, what is my understanding, about 95% of that meeting, and I had to leave for a family emergency. Thank you.
Dr. Glassberg, transportation recognition.
Yeah, we're going to do the PTA board appreciation, but I just wanted to show the board some of the work that our students have done. We had two students, currently seventh grade students, Rebecca Gessler and Elizabeth Tanner, who worked on this project, and I'll pick it up so you can see.
Wow.
Those students did this in the wood shop class as appreciation for the transportation department for their stepping up to their plate, if you will, when they drove the school buses down to Washington, D.C. So they constructed that this year in seventh grade in their wood shop class using CNC router and made this for transportation. They told me just to take it down and hang it up, but I just wanted to show everybody here and give them a little bit of recognition, and we will be sending them a letter thanking them for their good work, and this will hang in our new transportation department facility for quite some time. So congratulations to those two ladies.
Thank you, girls. Thanks again to all the drivers that stepped up for that effort, and Dr. Glasspool for putting it together.
Sherry, from PTA here? Oh, there we go.
All right, well, we just had the PTA school board recognition dinner, and on behalf of the PTSA and PTAs, Plum School Board members, you generously contribute your time and talents toward the success and advancement of our borough's education system. You represent our community, your dedicated volunteers, community leaders, our neighbors, and our friends. Plum Borough PTAs, PTSAs, and Council are happy to give to Plum Borough Community Library $100 on your behalf. Thank you for all that you do.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Thank you very much on behalf of the board. Appreciate everything that you do for not only the school district and the children, but us as board members. Thank you very much.
So January, I apologize. So January is School Board Director's Appreciation Month, and as is a tradition here, we get the school board a certificate, and you can see the bags in front of them is a small token of our gratitude for all of the time and attention that they devote to making the school district a better place. And it is quite a number of hours, not just physically here, but reviewing material that we send home. So on behalf of myself, the staff, the students, and residents, thank each and every one of you for all the hours that you put in.
Thank you, Dr.
We have two student features this evening. I believe that one of the individuals is not here. But Dr. Yemnitsky, can you step to the microphone and just introduce the folks for me?
We have one in attendance so far tonight, so we'll start with him. I am going to turn it over to Mrs. Gestrich, who is going to acknowledge a third grade PIVX student for some pretty special math work that he did.
I
am happy to be here this evening to introduce you to Danny Caruso. Danny, if you'll come up and join us. Danny was selected as a national winner in the Think Through Math 12 Days of Christmas contest. For most students, holiday break means sleeping later, relaxing, and playing games. But for this young man, it also meant logging in and practicing his math skills on Think Through Math. Think Through Math is actually an online math program that we, as a district, have been encouraging our students to utilize for both remediation and for acceleration. And it allows the children to not only have lessons presented in a fun and online format, but it also allows the teachers to track their progress and encourage them to continue, and then also offer some remediation if needed. One unique feature of this program is that it does allow for children to, as they are logged into the program, to seek live teacher help. And they are able to click on a button and have a teacher on the other end of their internet connection assist them with whatever it is that they're struggling with in that math problem. For Danny, because he logged in over Christmas break and passed three or more lessons while he was on that break, he was eligible to win, and he did. We were very proud of him to hear that he was selected to win not only an Amazon Fire tablet, a t-shirt, and a sports bag, and the Think Through Math representative came out to the school and presented that to him right after the new year. And I would like to end by simply encouraging all of our students to continue to log in. Think Through Math runs motivational contests every month, and we would love to see another winner here in Plum. Congratulations, Danny.
Danny, would you like to say any?
I know.
This is your opportunity, open mic. Would you like to say anything? Slide right out.
I thank my mom for making me do it for 3 lessons, and I thank my teacher for letting us do Think Through Math.
Thank you again, and congratulations. We'll come back with recognition next month for the young man who's not here today.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Glasspool. Congratulations. Moving on, were there any citizens' comments? We're going to do a little different tonight on either agenda or non-agenda items. That's fine. Doesn't matter.
Tim Sandstrom, 707 De Havilland Drive. I'm going to jump the gun a little bit on you guys because my comments deal with your preliminary budget that's posted online. One of my concerns is, as I read the preliminary budget, you have listed your delinquent taxes as projected revenue for next year to the tune of $1.5 million. By definition, people didn't pay them the first time. We sat at the last meeting and you were considering selling them for 50 cents on a dollar to an organization because you don't think you can collect the 1.5. So I don't understand how 1.5 is projected revenue in that budget for next year. My second comment on the budget is a disturbing lack of planning as far as capital projects. Last month, several of you spoke in favor of the redistricting plan that would send fifth and sixth grade to O'Block. Monday the 23rd, the O'Block boys basketball team had a home game with Penn Trafford. While the eighth grade boys were playing, every time the ball went to one end of the court, three people came out and mopped the wet spots on the floor. When the seventh grade game began, it started to rain outside and inside. When a young man from Penn Trafford fell, the responsible adult, the referee, said, "That's it, this game's over, 9-7. You know, there's nothing in this thing. You know, I've seen Bob come here, I've seen Denny Russo come here and tell you, you're gonna have to put money into O'Block at some point, or 3 years from now, you're gonna say, where are we gonna send all these kids who we had at O'Block? And Those are my 2 points I would like you to look at before you pass that preliminary budget, because you're a million and a half short if you're counting the delinquent taxes as revenue. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other?
My name is Chad Salerno, 740 Old Frankstown Road, and I'd like to make a statement of concern. Sure, thank you. Most of you don't know me, but you will over the next few weeks, months, or however long it takes to get justice for my daughter that was physically assaulted in this district under your watch. Premeditated assault that happened in a high school cafeteria January 18th. Yet another blemish on this district's record. For some that have been sitting on this board, it seems to be a recurring problem. There's a common denominator amongst this. It's once again ignored. You can pass the buck to those below you, but ultimately, Dr. Glasspool, I hold you responsible. Where is your leadership? When is enough enough? How many times does a student need to go in front of the local judge before action is taken? Do we need to have events like those that happened at Franklin Regional, or worse, a Columbine, before you decide to take action? How many chances do we keep giving? There is only one board member that has been proactive and has not swept this concern to my wife, myself, and this community under the rug. Thank you, Vicki Rossler. Many of you have been emailed and made aware of the situation and only chose to react once told to do so. Some haven't reacted at all. And to me, as a parent, as a citizen, and part of this community, is appalling. Where do your interests lie? I have a daughter that is fearful of coming to school. She fears and has concerns for her safety. Most of you are more concerned with what people are wearing. You are more concerned with words. How about being concerned with someone being physically assaulted? My kid was the victim. Victim. Can you guarantee me the safety of my child and every other child in your district? Can you? I will not stand for my daughter's education, safety, welfare to be jeopardized due to the district's lack of duty of care. Keep being politically correct. Keep catering to the degenerates and repeat offenders in your schools. Then again, it seems to be the company you keep. Keep showing that taking no action against the horrible actions of another is acceptable. Pretty fitting from a district that takes no action whatsoever unless told to do so from outside authorities. If you allow the student to return to this school, this will just be another punch in the face of my daughter by you. Last, like I said, I mentioned justice. I'm here for justice for my daughter and for all the students in this district. Review your policy, follow your policy, be a leader. I say this to all, that's all I'm gonna say. You can sit there together in front of us, or you can stand with your community. There's one thing I guarantee, this community will stand together. Do the right thing, and do not allow the student back in our schools. Thank you.
Salerno, 740 Old Frankstown Road. I am the mother of that child that my husband was just talking about, and I'm going to try to keep myself together. Does anybody know on the board or anybody here what it feels like to get a phone call by your husband saying your child was assaulted at school and is being sent to the ER? I do. I know what that feels like. Or does anyone understand the pain of hearing your child cry because she's fearful of what will happen to her when her assailant returns to school? I have lived this nightmare since the incident, January 18th. How would you feel if this was your child? Let me ask you, Dr. Glasspool, your daughter was present and seen the attack. Let me ask you how you would react. Would you be okay with this child in the class or even in the building with your daughter? I think not. Not only was my daughter assaulted, but now lives in fears. When she questions me why the student seems to have more rights than her, the victim, I have no answer for my daughter. I hear administration tell me that they will do what they can to keep my daughter safe, but they can't guarantee her safety. They tell me my daughter can be homeschooled, but can't take her AP classes because they're not offered online. Let me ask you, why should I be the one trying to ensure that my child gets her education? It should be the attacker that is trying to figure this out. Her attacker is too busy posting the videos on social media and posting emojis about her being suspended. So I ask you, who do we protect? The victim or the criminal? Tell me, the mother of this child, that my daughter does not matter and she has no rights. And I will tell you, I will make sure that justice is served. I am an educator myself and have been in education for 25 years. And I am trained to be a problem solver. What I am looking for are possible solutions that will not only provide safety for my child, but also will not rob her of a full academic potential. Thank you.
Can I comment?
I want to just mention to the board that because of some federal privacy laws, we cannot discuss publicly particular students, but it can be discussed in executive session. So if you wish to comment, please make sure you don't mention any names.
I guess what really bothers me about this, because I have been speaking with Mrs. Salerno, is to hear a parent say that her daughter feels very unsafe, and to hear a parent tell me that she's worried about the safety of her daughter. I just can't get past this. I've reached out to administration, I've reached out and asked for a specific plan, a policy, a protocol. Tell me what you're gonna do for this daughter to make sure she's safe. I can't imagine the phone call when you received it, how you felt. It breaks my heart that your daughter is under distress and to see you under distress. I wanna know what we can do for her. She deserves an education. I'm not talking about the discipline of the other girl or what happened, but to hear a child say she feels unsafe in our school, I have a big problem with that. Is there any response?
No, I think definitely it's an issue. I wasn't aware of it, and I apologize. I was not aware. We had an initial email the first day, and I thought it went away, but this isn't really the discussion area, the meeting, just so you folks understand.
Right.
And I think we definitely need to address it in safe and supportive schools, Mrs. Rossler. Not right here, right now,
and
but at this meeting tonight at safe and supportive schools. So everyone else gets a chance to comment, too.
Thank you.
Karen Oklaviva, 500 Prep Road. Been here multiple times talking about safety, security, situations that happen in the school. It's been consistent. At what point is the majority of the board going to stand with our children and the innocent victims of assault and abuse? What more needs to happen to our children for you to do something to fix the problems plaguing this district? I've been attending these meetings since 2014. Very little has changed. You pretend to change it. You talk about it ad nauseum, but then it just goes away. When the public eye's not on you, you just table it. It just goes away and no decisions are made. Regency is another example. You talk and talk and talk, but no action is ever taken. You voted for a safety coordinator to be hired months after talking about it. This was in 2015. You voted for it majority vote, which majority vote means that goes into action. Where is it? Where is he? Maybe if the safety coordinator would have been hired, this wouldn't have happened. And this is just one that we know about. How many others are out there that are afraid to say something? The problems plaguing this school have increased from sexual assault to physical assault, to racism issues. How many more innocent children have to become victims, have to be hurt, before you step up and do something? Make a decision, stand with our children. I don't know, it all comes down to accountability. I mean, there's no accountability. You guys say you're gonna do something, you all agree to it, but then there's nobody here going, okay, let's act, let's make this happen. I mean, instead of being reactive all the time, we've been reactive for 5 years or more, let's be proactive. Come up with a solution, fix the problem, stop talking about it, make a decision, move on, put our children first, and act upon it. That's all we're asking. I mean, no one else should be hurt. I shouldn't say no one. I should say no other child should be hurt. You're here for the children. We're all here for the children. It's not about me. It's about my daughter. I've said it multiple times. My daughter does not feel safe in this school. No, she hasn't been bullied, but she's worried about what's going to happen with teachers. She's worried about now that this is out there, what's going to happen. It is not a safe place. We still haven't discussed Alice training. What happens in that? Do we have a lockdown program in place? These are all things. The safety, the board went away. The committee that Vicki started went away because you guys didn't want it anymore. You told us it took too much time. It took too much out of your days to worry about the safety and security of our children. It was too taxing to the board. Now, not everybody on the board, but a lot of the board, it was too hard for you to make that commitment to put our children first. Who does that? What school board says, our children aren't worth it, I'm too tired, I'm gonna go home and go to bed instead? Well, children get assaulted. That's about all I have to say. I mean, I've been here, I'll be here again, I'll be here again, I'll be here again, because until you guys make a decision and stop talking about it and start doing something, I will be here and I will say the same thing over and over again until you take action. I just pray to God that somebody isn't killed before that happens. That's my biggest prayer.
Any additional comments? Agenda, please.
Facilities Committee, Mr. Rich Zucco, Chair. Recommend waiving policy 707, use of facilities for the Western Pennsylvania Bruins Girls Basketball Club.
On behalf of the committee, I'd like to make that recommendation.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion to the motion? No discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed say no. Motion carries.
Recommend approval of the Western Pennsylvania Bruins Girls Basketball Club use of facilities request as listed.
For use as requested. I would like to make that recommendation on behalf of the committee.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion to the motion? No discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed say no. Motion carries.
Recommend approval to pay the GOB invoices for Regency Park at Old Holiday Park as attached.
On behalf of the committee, I'd like to make that recommendation.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion?
Yes, I discussion. Do.
Okay, Doc.
Why were these separated? They were normally in the GOB invoices. And then I separated them.
They were requested.
Who requested them?
I get them.
Ms. Stepnick requested I separate them by category, Regency Park and then transportation.
So my question is, if somebody does not vote for number three, say we get majority and we don't vote for that, for the GOB invoices, how do they get paid?
Majority.
How do they get paid then?
The majority.
If the vote is no, she's saying.
If the vote is no, the majority votes.
Oh, then how do they get paid? How do we pay the bills if we don't vote to pay the bills?
Well, I mean, it's not gonna come out of the GOB, that's what I'm saying.
Can I give a reason why I asked them to be separated? I asked last January if we could continue accumulating GOB on a project that was stopped, or a year later, and we still have no project. And then in light of seeing that letter from our bond council, how the Regency bond and the use of it, I'm not comfortable voting for any more GOB anything regarding Regency, because there's no Regency coming along.
How would you pay for it if the majority said
no? I'm not the one that ended the project. I'm just stating a fact. We have a letter from bond council, and I'm sorry, but I'm going to hold true to that. I voted for that bond to build a school, and it did not happen, and I'm not voting to spend any more money out of that bond that involves that school. I have a very big concern for it.
Is that necessarily true, though? Because wasn't there a bond resolution where it was changed, not only to Regency, but it was changed to?
We saw a resolution.
It was amended.
Wait a second.
It was amended.
So you're saying you didn't vote on that to change it not only to Regency, but also purchase the bus garage, the bond itself?
That's done. We bought the bus garage. That's
why. And then you voted for that.
The transportation facility, yeah. That's it. I'm not voting. There's no Regency. There's no building happening. We were given specific deadlines in August, on August 23rd, from bond council as to how that money was supposed to have been spent, and it did not get spent that way. And I'm not voting for it. It's my prerogative to ask for this to be divided. We've divided many of other motions that others have asked for, and I asked for this to be divided because I'm not voting for it. It's my personal decision.
Does that have to come to a vote for that to be divided out separately? Does there have to be a motion and a vote? Like we have on other items in the past, Lee?
You have it in your agenda, separate motions, so there's no need to do a motion to separate.
So it's your agenda, Mr. Zucco. Did you ask your committee chair? Did you ask for that to be separated out? Did you approve that?
No, but I didn't really see any objection to it either. As we've all, we have gone through a lot of other things where we would split the recommendations up just so that some people can have a specific, I don't know how to put the word looking for, say, that I didn't vote for something or I did vote for something. And I think the board should have that prerogative, but I don't think it's going to have any real bearing on the actual votes and paying the bills.
I agree, but that's your committee, so you should have approved that to be separate, did you? That's your agenda.
I asked very publicly last week for it to be separate. Well,
the way the board works is it's Mr. Zucco's committee, so we discussed that. That should have been discussed at the committee of the whole, and then that should have been approved at the committee of the whole.
It was discussed at the committee of the whole. I asked publicly at that meeting, could those be separated? And Tim looked around, and no one said no.
Okay, and I apologize.
I asked very publicly, could that be separated?
I apologize that I was not at that meeting because I was nursing a back injury.
Right.
And I didn't look at it as far as whether somebody else requested it, but in my absence, if there were no objections, I don't see any objections either, so.
But to be clear, that bond covers other items because it's been amended since it was originally taken out.
It has been amended.
And can we clarify what all items are in that bond?
I actually have it.
I'd have grave concerns not paying invoices for goods and services that have been provided to the district when the funds were available.
I agree with Mr. Colella. I'll vote yes.
Okay, my prerogative to vote no.
So, Sue, to answer your question, there is that resolution that was sent to your email.
Right.
It was changed back in 2014.
Before we were on the board?
Correct, before us. Not only for Regency Park, but for other projects, including
Thank you.
But the letter from Bond Council of August of 2016 was very specific in the percentage we had to spend on an elementary school.
Didn't he say we could just change that to a resolution? It would be fine?
Well, that's fine. And again, it's my prerogative to vote no to pay this.
We had a conversation at the discussion of the whole.
Vote no anytime.
Specifically regarding that. We can talk about it again. I don't have my notes in front of me, but I think I sent that information out in an email as well.
Yeah, yay. Any other discussion?
No.
Okay. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed say no.
No.
Motion carries.
Recommend approval to pay the GOV invoices for transportation facilities as attached.
On behalf of the committee, I'd like to make that recommendation also.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? No discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries.
Mr. Zucco will make a report.
Make a report on that real quick item. On that item number four for transportation, I've got the actual invoices here, and they were actually for out of district transportation invoices from Roenick. So that's what those were for. In conjunction with that, not too many new items to report this month, new, a except the transportation facility seems to be fully operational. Last month, we had a few communication items that needed completion, such as transmission towers, cables, et cetera. I believe they're all complete now. We finished our internal and external district-wide security systems last December, and we have the same type of communication camera upgrades in our buses. The thing that I don't have to report on is that, yes, there was no decision regarding the redistricting and construction projects because information is still being gathered and analyzed. A month or so ago, the district commissioned a new demographic study, and the results are starting to come in. I believe Dr. Glasspool is to meet with Davis Demographics later this week or sometime in the very near future. And this was commissioned because there were objections to using the prior demographic study because it was several years old. As an update on that study from Davis Demographics, they've completed the geocoding. Don't ask me what all this means. They created a student generation study, created a birth factor, and collected new development information, new development meaning new housing developments that are going on. So we should be having that a little sooner than later, hopefully. And yes, I've been pushing to try to get this Regency issue settled for 3 years now, and I'm very frustrated also. But every time we want to do and get the most up to current information or somebody's not happy with the information we have, it takes more time and more money. Hopefully this will be coming to a conclusion very soon, and the board will make a decision one way or another, and we can move on and give some people peace of mind. That's all I have, Dr. Glasspool.
I have some comments to make. In my opinion, I think we should move forward with the model that one of the models that Tim presented last meeting about the K through 4 at Pivac, K through 4 at New Holiday Park, 5th and 6th graders at Center, and 7th and 8th at Oak Block. In terms of the kids and the education, I think it makes a lot of sense, and especially in particular, we're going to keep the age group somewhat close together. And with regards to the budgetary restraints and the finances, I think it definitely makes a lot of sense. You're not going to have to do any borrowing or major construction because we really don't have the finances for that right now. And I just think I think going with this option makes a lot of sense for a lot of reasons. I think the board should consider moving forward with this rather soon.
I agree with Steve. I'm really looking forward to Dr. Glasspool meeting with Davis Demographics. Actually, Dr. Glasspool, I'd like to be included in that, and I think the board members should at least be able to sit in on that. It's exciting to see that you and Dr. Yamnitsky have given the community and the board two options to look at. We need to, I believe, very quickly get input from Davis Demographics. We have a parent workshop session for input scheduled for the month of February. I think we need to move ahead on this. We've been waiting too long. I've been asking for 13 months to see numbers of how we could fit our existing student population into our existing buildings. And finally, after 13 months, we're moving on that. I think we need to move with community input, get our community input in February, come back in March and make a decision once and for all, whether it's the 5-6 and 7-8 model or 5-8 model with having K through 4, one building at each end of the borough. I think they're both excellent options. It's time to move on. Our options that we've had over the past year won't work. Not only do they incur additional debt, we lose an athletic field, which are very valuable properties in our district. We need to make a decision in March and move on with this, get our parental community input, and get these kids out of the old Holiday Park building once and for all. We've dragged this on too long. I'd like to make a decision in March. Dr. Glasspool has stated that it's clear that effective instruction outweighs any effects of grade configuration, and I agree. We've looked at study after study. I think in our community, either one of the two options that were presented by our administrators in January would be a fantastic solution and provide excellent education for our students, and as a sidelight, would fit better with our budgetary constraints.
I agree with that. And Sue and Steve have been consistently asking to see if the students will fit in our existing structures. I think this 5th to 6th grade model is a good option for the entire school district, the students. I don't like the 6th or 8th model. the reasons I don't like is, first of all, it's not a middle school. I think it's going to be the same scenario as the bus garage. You just keep putting money into that school to make it right. I like the fifth through sixth as far as the age groups with the kids. And I think we have a great staff. You know, it's a shame that it did take 13 months to get information to find out they actually fit. So, you know, I just, you know, I remember emailing Rich back in January saying, can we move this process forward? Can we, you know, is there anything I can do? I'll be at every meeting. And here we are like 13 months later. So I just don't want that to happen again.
Oh, and to answer Mr. Sandstrom, oh, sorry, Vicki. You done? Yeah. I just wanted to answer Mr. Sandstrom's concerns because I am concerned about the roof at O'Block. That's been an ongoing issue. And if we go with one of the two options presented by our administrators, we would have bond funds still remaining that we could address the roof issue and any other urgent issues at O'Block, and we may need to address some adaptation of the building at center to address the educational needs of the children. But it's thought that initially we would have enough bond money remaining, approximately $4 million, I think.
Yeah,
Mr. Zborchek, thank you.
Yeah, four, yeah.
So that, just to answer Mr. Sandstrom's comments about O'Block, we can't continue with that roof like that. But we would be able to if we go with one of these two educational models.
Are we done? Okay, let's backtrack a little bit here. And I don't recall saying that the Davis demographic study was complete. I said that it's in progress and they have some information. And I think there's some other things that need to be added on that they wanted to discuss with the district administration. I don't think it's right to move forward on anything at this time. Not that I'm stalling, but if people will remember, there was a long-term plan. We had built two elementary schools and started on the transportation system, and we had one item left to do, and that was Regency. That has been kicked back and forth because every time the board changed, the direction changed. And that's been kind of frustrating. But we also wanted to keep everything open. So when it was narrowed down to like three or four possibilities, you have to understand we have to go through a lot of information to compare everything. Because if we don't, let's put it this way, we're scrutinized very, very closely, and if we miss something, it's definitely brought to our attention. So we have to go through every option very carefully, and every time someone has a new question, we have to look into it. That takes time, and it takes a lot of money sometimes to do these studies. In conjunction, when one group wants one item, and we had it narrowed down to three, then we got it down to, actually we had a plan to build an elementary school. That was nixed, and we had to start all over again. At that time, I think we had three options, and people weren't satisfied with those three options, so we opened it to public scrutiny, and I believe we ended up with 13 new options to look at. So we had to look at 13 options and compare everything, and we'd have to do everything from bus routing and class size, number of classrooms, grade configuration. We had to do it all. We got it narrowed down again to like two or three, and then I guess within the last month, all of a sudden we have another one thrown at us that, again, not being the chair of facilities, I don't remember everybody any bringing it up to me, Sue, and all of a sudden there was all this information about this newest and latest idea. So with all due respect, I think it has to be scrutinized just like all the other options were, you know, scrutinized, and see how it plays out, not just because it was the last thing that somebody recommended. So on that, I'd say, yes, it's not a dead issue. Hopefully we can move on it soon, but let's not kind of push it into the forefront like it's the only thing or the only option that's viable.
No, but I tried to get these numbers last year, and I was consistently told it wasn't possible, and I disagreed for a lot of reasons. And then finally, now this month, we were found out it was possible, and the numbers prove it. So I think it was been more of a delay by, you know, we weren't getting the right information from administration.
Sometimes you just don't want to believe the information you get. I've seen this board go many times. Where if somebody's not happy, we have to have a new study, or we have demographic studies, we have facility studies, we have studies with the engineering studies. We do comparisons. We get all kind of information about class sizes. I mean, I'm looking at the one that we have here for, what was down the agenda somewhere. Bear with me, it's six pages down here. Research into practice on grade configuration. Principal's research review. Early childhood and parenting collaborative. See, there's a lot that goes into all this stuff. And it's not as simple, Steve. And sometimes, I don't know, we ever got the impression that something wasn't possible. Sometimes there are things that are not possible, but getting information is not one of them.
I don't agree with that, because I have heard Steve and Sue consistently say, I think the kids will fit, can you give us the numbers? And we never got that information, Rich.
I think what it is because you, and I hate to say it this way, but being relatively new on the board or the newest members, we had had information maybe 2 years earlier. And all you have to do is add the up, you know, you look at the kids that were in third grade, they're now in fifth grade. And you know exactly what the numbers are, and you just say, you know, something's not going to work. It's not going to change because everything just slides forward, you know.
We were told you can't do it that way.
Well, I mean, you've heard the outcries that we don't want to have. I mean, I just saw recently in the newspaper that we were going to have like 30 to 40 kids in a classroom. I've heard that kind of number tossed out, even as high as 50 and 60 kids in a classroom. And I don't know where it all comes from, but it's not never going to happen. We're just never going to allow that to happen. So I don't know where to say it's not possible maybe to, in terms of having a good educational experience and to be able to have our kids in overcrowded classrooms.
The fifth and sixth grade being open center, that is with a renovation. So to say that they actually fit is false without a renovation. Is that correct?
We have to wait for David's demographics.
Yeah, I'm just going to go on record. The conversations that we've had here at the board level, have all stemmed around closing the school and consolidating all of the elementary students. I'm still not convinced the students are going to fit in the configurations that were most recently discussed without significant renovations to classrooms, specifically at Center Elementary School. So, again, I'm not going to say anything at this point about what's going to happen because we haven't gathered the data. We haven't looked at those physical, those facilities. And we haven't matriculated students and geocode students, which is what Davis Demographics is going to do. More importantly, then, provide us with the birth rates and the progression of students, matriculation, new houses, and whatnot. So it's more complex than counting the number of kids and divide them by our classrooms. And I think everybody understands that, specifically since we redistricted in 2015, and we had the issue with the families from Frankstown Acres. And we discussed that for several months about where to put those kids and where they fit and how they matriculated through and keeping them with peer groups. So, and that was one neighborhood of like 30 houses. So now we're looking at, you know, at the entire borough. So it's extremely complex and we're really gathering lots of data. You know, we've got parent meetings set up. We've got meetings within the buildings with all of the staff. We hope to get a survey up on the website soon. And again, conversations here at the board. So I just think it's too early to say what's going to work, what's not going to work, and what fits. You know, we continue to have this conversation. The most important thing is the teacher in the classroom with the children, regardless of configuration, regardless of what that classroom looks like. So I think this is going to be the conversation really for the next 60 days, at the very least, to gather all of that data to move forward and make a decision.
Dr. Glasswell?
Mm-hmm.
I think we all learned a lesson in the prior board with Regency when we thought we were renovating and then go back to the plans and find out that was not possible. Before making any decision, I think it's wise that we find out truly what the costs are going to be to get rid of the leak at O Block and make whatever additional capital improvements being done there. But also, what is it really going to cost to make Center a 5-6 building? What is it going to cost to make Holiday Park and Pivot a true K-4? Because those buildings are set up for the runs that they have. And so there's going to be a configuration cost in those buildings as well. And a transportation cost for this. So I think we need to look at short-term and long-term costs for all of these. So when we make a decision, we're actually able to tell the community, this is what it's really going to cost. Not This is what we have left in the bond, and so that's what we have. We need to really know the cost, the true, what it is for lockers, what it is for the individual bathrooms in the kindergarten, what it is for different start times. I mean, those are real conversations that I think, I mean, those are things that have been said to me, but truly, I mean, there's a lot of that that goes around, and I regret with the Regency original vote with that was, why didn't we go in and get that initial, this is really what it's gonna cost before we voted to renovate, and then we voted to build new, because we were always building a new Regency. So I want that fact first, like what's the real cost for the new, and I want what's best for the students and the best learning environment, and I don't want large class sizes, but I wanna know truly what the cost is as well.
So can you create a timeline for us so that we understand as a board what, you know, when you're gonna start looking at contractors, have them give us a price or an estimate, or do we have, like, what do we have to do, Tim? Could you provide that and give us a timeline to the community?
Absolutely. I think, you know, what you gotta decide is what you wanna build. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that's the first, I mean, you know, we can get, you know, does the board wanna start to incur architect engineering costs on multiple projects, knowing that we're not gonna do one, or at least to get an estimate? I mean, I think the responsible thing to do is to, again, gather the data. I mean, the plan was in place, you know, going back to 2010, and the plan changed, the plan changed, and the plans changed. But there was always a plan. Right now, we don't have a plan. So gathering that data, taking a step back, and getting the collective ideas of the community at large moving forward, and then gathering that data and deciding, I think, is, I can certainly try to put something together as far as a timeline, et cetera. Reach out to architects, but again, then the question is, who would you like me to talk to? Kimball, BBH, another option? You know, I'm not so sure that this is the right time to talk about all of this because we're still gathering all of that data to make decisions.
Yeah, I think all that conversation is great on the tactical level, but there are three things that, in my mind, this board, somewhere along the line, has to have to start to have discussions about, some on a national level, some on a state level, and I'll just go through them real quick. First of all, we all know that vouchers may loom on the horizon for every school district in the United States. This board needs to have a discussion, what will vouchers do for Plum Borough? Mm-hmm. The second issue is charter schools. Charter schools are expanding. Mm-hmm. And as a board, if you're going to redistrict or gonna build new schools, you need to start having conversations. What if a charter school bought the old Holiday Park School? Now, we get some experience because a charter school bought a elementary school in neighboring Gateway School District, and their enrollment declined dramatically, but you need to have that conversation at the 40,000 foot level, not the micro minutia level that we're trying to look at. And thirdly, most importantly for the citizens of this borough and the citizens of Pennsylvania, there is still great conversation that will be had in this session of legislation at the state level called the Property Tax Independence Act, where property taxes are eliminated by the use of increasing sales tax and a higher wage tax. Now, whether that passes or not, but there's conversations at the state level. What does that mean for this district? I mean, these are the conversations this board has to start happening, concomitantly at all the tactical stuff that you're talking about. But if you don't have these things and you don't have these discussions, a year from now, you're gonna be having them. And it's gonna impact what's going on right now. So I would urge the board to push back a little bit, start looking at things strategically, maybe have another strategic planning education committee that was done in 2010, 2011. And take a deep breath before you start moving into things like that. These things loom on the horizon, and they're not gonna go away. So please, I would urge the district and the board to do that. The Property Tax Independence Act is something that is gonna impact every property owner in Plum if it's passed. And you need to know the consequences. I sent information out to the board about it. We need to make sure that we get our legislation liaison, Ms. Stepnick at Harrisburg, to find out about it. We need to get our senators here. We need to get our congressmen here to talk about it and find out their input and find more information about it. And we need to get that information out to the community because the community needs to know about that too. If your school property taxes were reduced 85%, it'd be a great thing for Plum Borough. So again, there, There's the tactical stuff that we're talking about, but also there's strategic stuff that has to be gone along concomitantly with that stuff. So just a little bit of my thought about it.
Thank you. Personnel Committee, Mr. Steve Schlock, Chair. Recommend approval of items 1 through 14 as listed.
On behalf of the committee, I will make that recommendation.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? We're grouping all.
The Pivick family is going to terribly miss Mr. Kropelek and his awesome volleyball skills, so I wish him well in his retirement.
Agreed.
Just for the community, there was a number of things on the agenda that the board opted to collectively put together under personnel. No other discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion's carried.
Education Committee, Mrs. Sue Caldwell, Chair. Recommend approval of the transportation plan and memorandum of understanding between the Plumborough School District and Allegheny County Department of Human Services, Office of Children, Youth, and Families, as attached.
On behalf of the committee, I'll make that recommendation.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion to the motion? No discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries.
Recommend approval to award the bid for wired infrastructure to CCL Technologies, 50% to be reimbursed using E-rate funds, balance be paid with existing GOP funds as presented.
On behalf of the committee, I'll make that recommendation.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? No discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries.
Recommend approval of an overnight field trip as listed.
On behalf of the committee, I'll make that recommendation.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? No discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries.
Recommend approval of the following education agreements as listed.
On behalf of the committee, I'll make that recommendation.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? No discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries.
Recommend approval accept the following grants as listed.
On behalf of the committee, I'll make that recommendation.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion?
No, Mr. Colella, just to thank all our wonderful educators and administrators who work so hard to obtain those grants and those fundings for our schools.
It is wonderful. It's great.
Yes.
It is. It's a good thing.
Every month.
It is. You know, and I sit and I see these wonderful things coming in here, and it, you know, these corporations and organizations, you know, give our teachers and who do a wonderful job to teach things that are, you know, teachable in the unteachable scenarios. So it's really good things. No other discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries.
Ms. Caldwell has a report this evening.
Yes, thanks, Dr. Glasspole. We have been gathering some information. Dr. Yamninsky's been working with me with our foreign language program. Our foreign language program is somewhat outdated. We need to bring that up to a more current parallel with what's happening in the educational world and a global economy. So we've gathered some information, and I also have had some conversations with our AIU regarding options that are really exciting for our school district. So we're going to be talking about that more on the education committee agenda in March, and I'd like to ask the board to be open-minded about that and consider moving forward with some of the new options that we can bring to our students. It's really exciting, the different options of our world languages and world cultures that are available through the AIU. And I also just wanted to reach out to our administrators, teachers, building principals, that any suggestions that they have as we work through the budget process as educators to bring to the board that we can enhance our educational programs, but also make them match our community. Some of our classes at the high school or junior high may not be fully engaged with the student population. Bring suggestions to the board. That's what we respect, your professional excellence and your professional input. If you know of programs in other areas, you've heard in conferences, bring those ideas to the board. We're looking to make Plumborough an educational opportunity that maybe students in other districts don't have, something that sets us apart, that we're not always here in negative, that we have some new programs to offer students. So I would challenge our administrators, bring us your ideas. It's just exciting to be working on this world language program. I know there are other things out there. My expertise is in healthcare. Yes, I've been on the board for two different terms now. I know a lot of education, but I'm not at conferences every day. I'm not interacting with other educators, administrators from other school districts. Bring us your ideas and share with us. And luck would have it, that could probably also enhance our budgetary efforts as well. Also, I wanted to ask, we've talked about this in the past, for next month, an update from our biology department, our science department. We had discussed ninth grade biology in the past, and we wanted to have an update on that. Other than that, I think that's it. We have been talking about our ROTC program as well, and the enrollment numbers on that, so we look forward to ongoing updates on that and hopefully seeing that grow. Thank you.
Dr. Glass.
Sue, I just want to bring up something about the iPads with education. I know this is part of the budget and finance, but we did hear great things from the teachers, and I'm hearing great things from the parents about this one-on-one initiative, having iPads in the classrooms. I really think we should think about keeping iPads in our budget for the students. I know there's conversation about taking it out of the budget. One of my concerns is, I think the lease, a three-year lease is gonna be up next year, so we're gonna be on iPads. So do we rebuy or release iPads? Do we pay for them with the residual, what's left? I mean, we need to figure out how to keep this program going. If it's enhancing education, we need to keep it. I mean, that's
I
what
agree.
We're here for, but mm-hmm. you know, we need to really talk about that.
I wholeheartedly agree. And we know we're up against the wall with almost a $5 million deficit that, with 3 years of tax increases, will balloon to a $13 million deficit. One thought I have is to do a community outreach and see if we can get community buy-in for donations from the iPads. A GoFundMe page for Plum Borough School District, and see. We actually have some private wealth in the community that may be willing to contribute to funding an initiative such as iPads when those individuals in our community who may be able to contribute would like to see a positive note light shining on the school district. And I'd be willing to take on that initiative. I know Mrs. Rosser is working on a new, you know, getting some community donations for a new sign outside of the high school. Personally, in my heart, I'd rather work on donations for iPads. I'd rather go knock on benefactor's door and start a GoFundMe page for iPads before I would, and I'll donate to the new sign.
Well, thanks, Sue.
But okay. with our budgetary constraints, I would love to see the iPad program move forward, and that might be an option that we could look at to try to bring it. To me, it's an educational item that is a want more than a need, although we see how well it's working. Yeah, sure, we can keep going with what we have, but that's just an option. I've been thinking about it this past week, and if any of the board would be amenable to that, I'd take on that project.
Okay.
Just a thought, since you're asking.
I agree,
and it's worth discussing.
Do they have to be, I mean, I know it's one-on-one initiative with iPads, but do the teachers need iPads, or can they use the tablet?
The teachers already
have. We just want them on new laptops.
They already have the laptops.
Coincide with the iPad.
No, the students.
Right, the teachers have new Apple laptops.
Right, I know that.
So that way they were
we
always.
We can always add this stuff to the discussion session to discuss.
Yeah, I know.
Right, yeah.
You know, certainly, you know, we can set that for the upcoming month.
I did have one other thing I wanted to ask if we could discuss, because I know we did it sort of close to the last minute last year, and I know there was the U.S. Open and a bunch of other stuff going on, but, you know, before we know it, May will be here, and CPR Awareness Week will be here, and I know it's not a really large cost to the district, but I'd like to make sure we're getting that on our radar, getting it on our calendar, and allowing students more, maybe larger opportunity to sign up and do that again this year. I heard some really great parent feedback from that. The kids that participated. So, you know, if we save one life by doing a CPR during whichever week works for this schedule here in the high school.
Let's put on the agenda for March for education. That's great.
Because I think it takes time for
February.
Yeah, it should be for February.
We could just.
We did it very last minute last time, and it just.
Have the high school principal look into it and just make it happen.
Well, my other concern is, can it be part of our health curriculum? If we put on the agenda, we could.
I mean, some districts are starting to go to, it's a graduation requirement. I would, and I know we're under budget constraints, but I would really like the kids that want to participate. You know, if they're going on to do something else outside of high school, that would benefit. And again, it could happen in your own family. It could happen to your neighbor while you're over visiting and you need that CPR. So I would love the opportunity to expand that this year if we can. We have enough time to discuss it and really give it some real thought.
Let's put it on the agenda for February for education.
I just
see if we can get it in the curriculum. If not, we'll bring it in May.
I just have one final question. When is the program of studies? When do you want that passed by the board?
I believe it's on the agenda for next month.
Right.
February?
Yes, it is.
So I'll bring that up in finance because that has to do with finance. All right. Thank
Speaking
you.
Of finance, Mr. Sal Colella, Chair, recommend approval.
Recommend approval of the treasurer's report and bill payment. Motion and a second. Any discussion? No discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries.
Recommend approval to accept the budget transfers as presented.
On behalf of the committee, I'll make that recommendation.
I'll second that.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? No discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed say no. Motion carries.
Recommend approval to advertise for bid for the following items as listed: bus parts and athletic supplies.
On behalf of the committee, I'll make that recommendation.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion?
What are some of the athletic supplies that they are putting up for bid? I don't recall.
Baseballs, tape, softballs. If any bid aggregates over, I think, 10,000, which would be impressive. It's an aggregated. 19,000 dollars in athletic supplies.
Okay. Great, thanks.
Any other discussion, questions? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed say no. Motion carries.
Recommend approval to accept an agreement with AMCA Systems LLC for affordable health care and ECA tax track software license agreement as presented.
You know, with what's going on, I'm going to make a motion to table that.
That is not, after motion made and second, it's not debatable. You just vote on it. That's a motion to table.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah. All those in favor to table, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed say no. Motion carries. Table.
Recommend approval to enter an agreement with Northwood Realty Services for sale properties 3411 Leechburg Road, that's the old bus garage, and 1460 Greensburg Road, which is the upper building in the new bus garage, at a 6% commission rate. This contract will be approved by our solicitor as to form.
On behalf of the committee, I'll make that recommendation.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? No discussion. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed say no.
Finance Committee report. Mr. Colella will make this report.
Thank you, Dr. Glasspool. We do have a preliminary budget that was presented to us that there will be a vote on February 7th. We need to have a discussion before that meeting on delinquent taxes and capital projects that was brought to our attention, as well as several things that I've looked at moving forward. That being said, nothing's in stone. We still have another week to look at the budget. I got a copy of the annual financial report tonight. I'll be reviewing that. I'm going to look at some other things that may impact the budget. So more discussion on the budget that night before we vote. And that's really about it.
So we can't discuss any concerns now? Is that what you're
saying? If you want to talk, it's fine. If you want to talk about it, sure, go ahead.
Hey, John, a couple questions maybe. The P's are like the reimbursement, between 15 and 16 and 16 and 17, we pay considerably more, but then we got, as far as reimbursement, we got less. And shouldn't, I think I asked it before. The answer probably because the state was broke.
It was cash flow fixed from the state.
Okay.
Using that philosophy, our auditor said that we should book the FICA, Social Security, and the pension in the new year. So there was like $1.194 million that could have been booked in the prior year to show that, but because we were following the philosophy that the state was using a 10-month period as opposed to the 12, that's the reason why it was booked in the current school year. So it's a timing matter, and that's why looks lower, but you'll see the increase. Well, you won't see the increase this year because we'll always be 2 months behind.
So you're saying you don't think there should be any adjustments to the numbers in the future budgets?
That's mandated. We're mandated to get pension reimbursements, and it's based on your market value aid ratio. If an employee was hired after July 1st of 1994, it's based on market value aid ratio, which in our case fluctuates anywhere from 65 to 60% on any given. They were hired before July 1st of 1994, it's a flat 50% reimbursement. It's a mandate. The state doesn't have a choice. Now, I guess one choice they could have is to delay your payment. I guess that's a possibility, but they're mandated to make that pension payment based on those two factors, reimbursement factors. It's either 50% or market value aid ratio, so we're going to get one of those two, and that's mandated. They don't have an option. As our percent goes up, so does their percent because they're paying us that reimbursement percentage back. Does that make sense?
And then like the plan con, we got like the two increments, like the two sums, like with November, December, like $1.9 or $2 million. Is that we using that like for pay the bills like a May and June, or I thought that was also counted towards next year's budget too.
They
counted twice, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think you're saving 1.5.
Yeah.
That reason on the bond for next year, but this year, because this budget doesn't reflect the plan company, which so it's not really that large of a deficit. That plan company is all to the purposes there, and that's what created part of this deficit, was the plan company income.
Yeah, I want to walk you guys through this, just so we're all clear on that. Because it's a matter of moving money. So the money that we receive this year, we receive. And it's part of our cash flow. So it's in our pocket. It's our money to spend right now. So that's one matter. But the other matter is passing the budget, so for next year. So part of the plan for next year is we took the $5 million bond out this year, not use what we received in addition this year and roll that money forward as instead of using all $5 million for our pension bond this year, I'm saying we use $5 million minus the additional money we received over our budget this year. So that's $1.8 million we received more than anticipated this year. So I'm saying we not use that $1.8 million in this year's budget and use it to help balance next year's budget. Did I explain that good? Because I know that's tricky.
1.8 of the 5.
Right. We're not going to use it in this year's budget because we don't need it. We're going to use it in next year's. And I talked to Joe Masitella. He said we may have to change the wording of the way we took the issue of that $5 million bond out, but it's a liable thing that we can't do. We'll just basically skip one reimbursement. We pay pension costs, and then we get reimbursed for them through this bond. We would just basically skip one for this year, use that money in one payment of the following.
You're not using it for it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yeah.
I did.
And I just thought, like, in the preliminary budget, in my opinion, I think that the sale of properties, like on the revenue side, I think they're definitely overestimating revenues, and I think that for that regard, I think it's an irresponsible budget.
It's a reach. Yeah. There's no doubt about it. It's aggressive, but the properties are valued at substantially higher than that. But I understand that. It's only worth what someone's willing to pay for it. We are getting some interest in some of these properties, and it's worth mentioning now that they're not necessarily coming in the way we want them to come in, the dollar amount, but I mean, there are some interest in these properties, and so that's worth saying. But again, you know, there's other opportunities to make additional revenue. That delinquent tax sale claim, they're quoting us now at $1.8 million, not $1.5. That's $300,000 better than what we budgeted. That will be addressed. The real estate property taxes came in at a much higher assessed value than we originally planned for. You know, that came in substantially higher, which was another $80,000 of tax, real tax money that will come in next year that's not in our preliminary budget. So there's additional money coming net from that revenue. And I think one of the biggest levers that we have potential is transportation. If we do revenues right with transportation, we could substantially close that gap. So where we may be a little bit aggressive, and I'm with it. You know, that's aggressive plan for real estate sale. But I think that there's other places that we can keep working, keep finding ways to drive that revenue. Or the other side of it is, we talk about expenses and get very serious about expenses.
I wanted to bring some suggestions to the board as far as the expenditure side, consolidation and better staff efficiency, teacher to student ratio. Should I just let these one by one, Tim, or else?
Well, I think what people have to realize is that February 7th is passed a preliminary budget, which basically means we can raise taxes above the actual index if we choose to. Then we have 5 months, 150 plus days, to work all of the details out of the budget, whether that's adjusting revenues and or expenditures. So, I think in a different forum, with John sitting down with papers in front of us and having a conversation back and forth, taking notes is a better way to do it.
You're going to wait until after February 7th?
No, I think you can say whatever you want. I'm just saying that there's going to be an awful lot of conversation going on in the next 5 months before we finalize the budget.
My concern is that the budget is having been passed in February, that's a concern because there might be changes in that program studies not going to work if this changes. And also, what happened last year? We brought suggestions to the board. Rick, she said it. We thought of that before, maybe even knew on the board, but nobody knew on them. So my fear again, that's going to happen again this year. I think a crucial year. I think we missed the vote last year, and said it again. Said it before, said it again. And I don't see direction from board members who are bringing ideas of how John or you should look into the information. I mean, there were 3 emails this week regarding can you find the information on how much this would save. That takes John's time, that takes your time. And I see no direction from this board. I think it should stay at the board level at committee meetings, and you should direct, do we even have 5 people that are interested in moving this forward before they do any work. I just think it's a waste of time. I'll pay my statement. People can't be knocking out. I appreciate Steve, who's gone in weekly to visit John to work at people. He's allowed me also to him. And you've done your due diligence as a new board member to look for solutions to bring to the board. But we need to discuss that. We need to discuss some type of leadership and direction to all board members moving forward. So we're organized, we're all on the same page, and we give this school district direction. You have any comments on that, Jim?
I have a comment on it. I've sat on this board, this will be my 8th year, and I don't think I've heard anybody say an idea or a conversation was a waste of time. I'm sorry. I don't think any conversation is a waste of time. I think if you don't have conversations, you can never get anything accomplished. We have one of the 2nd biggest expenses in March. We have our 2nd bond payment, I believe, in March, John. And what John's probably going to do is do a cash position for us to tell us how much cash we have on hand, which was well within the timeline to look at the budget. So after that, then you have a better idea of looking at the budget. And if you don't have ideas moving forward as a board, then you will fail. Because those ideas are what you look at the future for. They may not be applicable this year, but whenever you do business planning, you do things in the short run and you do things in the long run. And you have to do both. So for somebody to come to a meeting and tell me something is a waste of time, it's just unconscious.
Was
an email. First of all, there's sunshine. You can't bring sunshine. Any ideas you have need to be said in the public. And number two, I stand by my statement. It's a waste of time. If you help him do from 7th to 8th grade, tell me what the cost savings is. Nobody on the board is going to do that. That's a waste of time. We need to give our administrators direction. Is anybody interested in moving to a 7th to 8th period at that high school? And then maybe at the next budget meeting, somebody from another meeting, and then you go through a list of suggestions, and we'll be advised to move forward, then we can have the whole thing do it.
I'll bring up this.
We have to approve program studies, because I think that's the problem.
That's the problem.
So then we need to have a budget meeting before.
There have been corrections to the programs of study after it's been passed.
There have, but we do have a meeting next week. We can only pass the preliminary budget, and we'll have a workshop and.
Could you see my consent, and that's the word where you get that, you know, emails?
I understand, but I guess, you know, the other conversation the board has to have is, what are we talking about? We're talking about tweaking the program of study, or you're talking about curtailing the programs? And that's a conversation that absolutely have to have in a public meeting, which will happen in a public meeting. But what I'm saying is, you know, let's get the agenda together, let's put it out there. Let's allow administration time to gather some information so that we can have an intelligent conversation about what we're talking about. I mean, I think that that would be on the agenda.
You know, there are three things that boards do, and they should do well: organize, deputize, and supervise. When you come up with an idea, you use those three guiding principles to get things done. And that's what we should do: organize, deputize, and supervise. You know, we don't have to micromanage things that go on at the administrative level. We have to come up with the idea and let the details fall in place. So.
We just
heard now, Vicki. We have $1.8 million left in the bond that we didn't use. We have $1.9 million for plant on money that we didn't use. Those monies, after the bond is payment, we have to look at our cash position so that we can look forward. You know, we're talking about a $5 million deficit. It may not be $5 million.
And we also might not get the revenue from the judging units.
No, this is money that we've already had. We have that money. It's in the bank. It's in our cash flow statements. So what we have to do is we have to find out how much our deficit is truly going to be. John needs to project that for us. He can project that for us, and we can move forward. That's a short time. It's 3 weeks away.
I think it would also.
If we're off on our revenue, that this throws that off.
But I think everybody also has to understand, you know, our budget's due, you know, June 30th. And, you know, the state still hasn't told us what funding we're going to get from them, and the federal government's memo. So, you know, we're still budgeting based on revenue that we know, which is 60% of our budget, and we're basing that on expenditures. And that's what the budget is. It's our best guess at the time. And this is our best guess on expenditures and revenues as of January. You know, 6 months before the budget needs to be passed. So as we get closer, that gap will be more fine-tuned and details will shake out. And I understand that there are some, you know, there's some differences, you know, in both the expenditures and the revenue. So as we know more information, that budget gets closer and closer. So that's just a preliminary budget.
Work
is all we're talking
about.
Well,
could just kind of bring this back together a little bit here. Finance committee.
Tim and John, I was going to bring this down, make suggestions. I guess next budget workshop or the next discussion meeting on the 21st.
What I would say to the board in general is, if you have suggestions on ways to increase revenue for all this credit given, or decrease expenditures, I would say to send those to John so he can kind of aggregate those for the board, so we can, you know, if there's information we can get very quickly together, then we can get that together, we can present that to the board, we can have a conversation, and get it on a budget workshop. We have budget workshops very frequently. I don't believe there are many school districts in Pennsylvania who've had budget workshops already outside of Palmetto. I mean, we have a very real budget compared to school districts in specifically Western Pennsylvania that I'm familiar with. So send that information.
I sent that in an email, so can we get that?
Yes, so okay. As we continue to discuss these things, we'll add you.
We're going to CC those to all the board members, and then that way John will be getting redundant requests.
I would just send them to John and have him put them on the list, and he can show up to the, you know, the publicized budget workshop. I don't know if anybody wants to get additional emails, and I get a lot, but no.
We don't necessarily give them some.
Good. We'll move forward with the policy committee. This is the roster chair. Mrs. Ross has reports.
Actually, I don't have too much to say because we did not pass the policies. We're still working on five or six policies, one of them including policy 707, which is many people here every year that we need to take a look at that policy. So I think we're going to reclassify schedule seasons, the fees and Sundays, and then all venues. So we're really going to do some work on that and come back with feedback.
Thank you. Safety and Support Schools Committee, Mrs. Rosser's chair. Mrs. Rosser has a brief report this evening.
I just have information on the community bullying forum. Joey Miskey has been working hard on it. It's February 9th. The Palmetto School District will host a community forum for parents on bullying prevention. Thursday, February 9th from 6 to 8 p.m. in the Oak Auditorium. This forum offers parents an opportunity to listen, learn, and ask questions. District administrators will provide an overview of current bullying prevention methods used in our schools. Dr. Nicholas, professional speaker and district partner, will discuss warning signs of bullying for parents. Lastly, Specialized Right will conduct a 90-minute workshop to help parents understand the complexity of social media and cyberbullying. I think it's important for the parents to be involved, and I'm very grateful for all the work we've done to put into this. I'm excited to attend and be part of it.
Yes, and the PTA has been gracious enough here at the high school. They're going to do the socialized right the next day with the students here. And I think it's important to understand from parents, sometimes you don't know what you don't know. And as the devices and apps become more difficult for us to navigate or even understand, I think that this may present some information that will help parents as well.
And I apologize for not bringing that up.
I think we need to address the parent concerns that came to the board tonight in this committee. For next month, maybe get some answers tonight, but I'd like to know, to address the concerns of the parents, number one, we're not the one SRO now. So I, as a board member, need to know where that SRO is based, number one, and we have a rough idea of where he's located throughout the day. I know he covers all of our building, which is a wonderful thing. School bus to have on SRO, but and beyond that, what other security personnel are available at this high school for our students during the day and at our middle school, in particular, our 7th grade overall school in particular, because those are the ages where there tend to be more issues. Not that something can happen in elementary school. So beyond that, where are we going with our safety coordinator? So I think these are issues that need to be on Safe and Supportive Schools discussion for February, and I really look forward to getting better protection for our students in the school so they are safer. That's a major issue that came to my attention tonight. I didn't realize that the situation was what it was, and I apologize to those parents.
And the other thing that I'd like some information on is our cameras and our connectivity to our local law enforcement and our county law enforcement. There are school districts in neighboring counties who have their cameras tapped into their county 911. My concern is, if I'm a student in school and there's an incident and I'm finding myself hiding in the cupboard or hunkered behind the desk over there, I'm going to have my cell phone probably, and I'm probably going to go 911 on my phone and dial, and that's going to go to Allegheny County. So I need to know where our cameras are connected, because Allegheny County 911 is the command center for major incidents like happened in our bordering municipality of Murraysville with Franklin Regional. That's the command center, and it is acceptable to have our score cameras available in a time of need to a 911 command center. Also, our local police should have access as well. And I'm not saying that they need to be sitting there watching what we're doing in the library every day, what our students are doing. I'm saying, in an emergency, do we have that connectivity with law enforcement, whether it be local or county? So if we can get that information for the February workshop, I'd appreciate it. On our cameras, where we're going with safety coordinator, and what are our sort of codes, where he's based and where he's spending the majority of his time, and what kind of security we have in high school and junior high. Thank you.
I just want to add to the York and continue Alice training. And I'll update you later on that.
Thank you. Transportation Committee, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Chair. Mr. Roberts has a report.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Dashwell. To reiterate something Rich said, the driver's love in the show that I'm going to show you the other day and talk to several of these. Annapolis and Scott were in good shape in terms of full-time drivers. We do need more subs because the class in progress now is 6 in the pipeline. The problem with this whole process is it takes months to get from ICE. By the time you go to the classroom or go to the 6 hours of the training, get the permits, get the testing, and so on and so forth, it does take quite a long time. One of the big glitches is setting up an appointment to actually get the test done. Scott has a plan to get himself and 3 others certified, so that we can be designated a third-party tester. We can test our own people. We can pay people who pay us to test their kids with their driver's book. So we work on a source of revenue. With the 4 examiners, with our lot, there's plenty of room to run a test. So right now, we're in a line, in a pipeline, to be a third-party tester from the school. So that was to get our kids, our drivers, plus give us a source of revenue for drivers. And I discussed the Compass computer program. It's very expensive, very intricate, very complex. And as much training as he has had on it, we were only scratching the surface of what we can do with that program. So this summer, he plans to take him and his assistant to a conference that Compass runs to learn their intricacies and what things they can do. For example, there was one program he called up. There were 7 tabs across the top, and he used 2 of them. And one wasn't even complete because he says, I can put IEPs in there, I can put the student needs a bus aid in there. From a planning standpoint, there's a lot they can do, but they just have to know how to do it. He told me that they already have money in the budget for travel expenses to go to this conference. So that should be very beneficial, maybe sometime this summer. We discussed the reimbursement, the fact that it delayed somewhat, and apparently we have the paperwork that we needed to do with that loss. It's been duplicated. The information was submitted last Friday, and Mike tells me as long as it was submitted before February 2nd, it won't affect the next disbursement. So we should do a case in yes, it's possible. Athletic committee, Mr. Michelle Geller, chair, recommend approval of hiring Mike Barco, senior high assistant volleyball coach, spring 2017 season contractor.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? No discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries.
Recommend approval to accept Aaron Diver, senior high volunteer assistant softball coach in spring 2017 season.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? No discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Motion carries.
Food Service and Nutrition Committee, Mrs. Michelle Stass, Chair, Mrs. Stephanie has a report to you.
Just really briefly, I was able to stop in the CJM the other day, and we've already sat down with you, John, and we're our breakfast is sold at low, and that's district-wide, and they you know, she thinks it might be good to change the mind. So I don't know how we make that better. I know when it was to a low, a lot was officially worked with us to create something so the kids can take that would qualify for that breakfast, especially for those that are on free and reduced and they're eligible for breakfast, be able to put something in the locker, right, that would last throughout the day so they would have their breakfast. But they are low, and again, it's, and I see the call at the park we got all the time, whether my son takes the bus or he gets dropped off many times at the same time the bus is leaving, he would have zero time to get in line, get food, eat, and get to his classroom. Because the building's open to the time the class starts. 15 minutes is not enough time to put hundreds of kids into a cafeteria and start them, you know, our rate of like that order breakfast. Whether they're eligible for free and reduced, that's what they choose to see their friends because they want our breakfast. And there's just not enough time. So while the sales are down, I'd like to try to find some creative ways to, again, bring them up, but also, you know, we have students that are eligible for things that should be able to. And it helps the district, but also it helps the students. So I don't know how we can tweak things going forward, but I see it in a large elementary school now. There's not enough time. I mean, there's barely enough time to. You're there early at 8:40, and you walk in, and you're one of the first couple dozen kids in line. You're getting there, and you're eating, but the rest of them are not. I'll work through some of the things other than it's my favorite.
March 6th, so Mustang would come to you, Mustang. Thank you. Intergovernmental Committee, Mr. Caldwell, Chair. We have Intergovernmental Committee scheduled for Wednesday, February 17th, 7 p.m. here at the high school board. Mr. Caldwell, you have a report this evening?
No.
Fort Grove Career Technology Center, Mr. Jim Rogers, representative. Mr. Rogers, you have a report.
Thank you, Pastor. At the meeting last week, the end results of the Schools USA Regional Conference was held on January 16th at Forest Grove. There were several hundred kids competed. 30 kids from, because these are from all technical schools all in the Polish area. 30 kids from Forbes were winners, 8 were plumb. And the Schools USA, I asked, what exactly is that? And it is a partnership of students, teachers, and industry worker organizations to help students prepare for the skills necessary to enter the trade workforce. Some of these competitions require testing instead of competitions. And the winners, the first best competition, in all the service tech, Matt Hansen, in building construction, Angela Calrico, CNC milling, first best is Alex Stapp, S-T-A-P-E, I hope I say it right. In job demonstrations, was Hannah Sipka, aesthetics, Manuel Augustine, aesthetics model, Cassandra Chemilinski, I think I got it right. In addition to that, some competitions don't have enough competitors, so the state students go directly to the state competitions. And there were several of those. There was Karina Singe, in crime scene investigation, and technical computer application, Elena McKenna, competed in Region 11 FBLA Regional Leadership Conference. FBLA stands for Future Business Leaders of America. And we had two kids place, and one kid placed in first place, Micah Sichota in computer networking, and we had another student who's going to the state competitors, Elena McKenna for the community service, the Invisible Girl Project in computer networking. All these kids will be going to Hershey in April to compete in these events on the state level. So our kids did a real fine job in this competition. Just a couple of quick other things here. Hands-on force in, for the kids at Cedar Place. The poem here will be February 17th, and the spring open house at 4 on March 16th. And one last item here, a talk to CNC has approached, CCAC has approached them to set up a dual enrollment program where the kids can take a class at CCAC, pay tuition, and it will count for college credits. The credits would be $106 a piece, which is cheap. And I was thinking, we have the Plum Foundation, there's some money there. If we have some kids that want to enroll in this, because they asked to have it, all their kids sit there. And they asked, would you be interested in it, and could your parents pay it? Some of the kids said yes, some of the kids said no. You know what? If we've got some money there from that Plum Foundation, thank you. Maybe we can pay the tuition for these kids if they want it, if they want to enroll in it. Because if we can get them credits for college, that's what we'll be outstanding for.
I have a quick question. Would that be at the CCAC campus,
yes,
or are they virtual?
Yes.
We already have some college credit programs here that students pay for, parents pay for.
This would be through Forbes, and I'm not sure the details.
Mm-hmm.
But it would be through Forbes, and the tuition is cheaper than that.
Right.
It's a dual enrollment kind of thing.
Would it be at the Forbes campus or across the street at CCAC?
I'm assuming it would be at CCAC, but I can't say for specifically. This is just in the planning stage,
okay,
discussion stage. But I have to be able to say if they set it up, then they can help with their tuition.
Thank you. East Area Schools, Ms. Michelle Gallagher, representative. There is no report this evening. Let us say the policy team. At this point, we need to recommend or open recommendations for a representative from the board. Majority of those present and voting.
And
voting. Abstentions don't count for anything.
Mrs. Caldwell?
Mr. Schwab.
Mr. Colella?
Steve Schwab.
Mr. Caldwell is absent. Mrs. Gallagher?
Michelle Stefan.
Mrs. Rossler?
Mr. Schwab.
Mr. Rogers?
Mrs. Stedman.
President's report, Mr. Kevin Del Del, President, in his absence, Mr. Colella will make this report.
I did have a couple legislative things that are just, all from my own perspective. Thank you. I did meet with Representative DeLuca within the past month. I had some questions for him, and in particular, how they pertain to our district. We discussed GOD monies and how we've had a problem receiving reimbursement on our GOD funds back to the district over the past year and a half. We know that the state did take a loan from China to fund the GOD monies that were owed to our districts. It's late. Excuse me, right, we were late getting those funds. So my concern to him was going forward, how long is that loan that they took with China going to continue to fund our GOD monies? Because we know our GOD obligations go many years into the future. And he informed me that that was enough to fund our GOD monies that are owed to us for the next 2 to 3 years. And after that, they are not sure how they will be funding our GOD monies. And the state is, I believe, several billions of dollars in debt with their budget. So just as a heads up, when we're planning things into the future and talking about funding projects, keep in mind, we don't even know 3 years from now how we're going to get our GOD monies reimbursed from the state, because the state does not know how they're going to get our GOD monies to give to the districts. That was the biggest thing to me, and that was a red flag. Also, I discussed with him the Milltown Road project. It's been put on hold. So he was going to discuss that with Dan Sessom from PennDOT. I also shared with him our concerns about the New Texas Road Rapid Bridge Replacement Project, which has been delayed, but that's going to shut down New Texas Road. We've been told they have been in contact with Dr. Flexible by letter. And that's the main artery through our district. So to stop our buses during the school year and have them go on New Texas Road would be a great disruption and expense and inconvenience for students and parents. So Representative DeLuca also said that he would reach out to Mr. Cessna from our district with PennDOT and get those answers for us. And I expect to hear back from him this week, if not, I'll give him another call. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. President's report. January already. Second 9-week report cards are available online. Many thanks to the congratulations for the extra effort from the teachers and their grant opportunities that they get in the school district. Thank you, board members, too, for all the hard work that you do. I know you put a lot of time and a lot of behind it. February is Black History Month, National African American History Month, and it's an annual celebration of achievement by Black Americans and a time for recognizing the central role of African Americans in U.S. history. And I just want to say, my grandson goes to this high school and had a course now, and the teacher was to talk about Martin Luther King and Thoreau, and they just did a wonderful job. When my grandson picks up it up and starts to read about Martin Luther King and his letters from the Birmingham jail, that's inspiring to find out that teachers put time like that into our school. So congratulations to those folks too. February 9th is Bullying Prevention and Parent Community Workshop, as you said. The 10th is 0 o'clock Valentine's Day dance. The 13th and 14th is U.S. Department of Justice. The Center for Safe Schools will be at the high school to conduct a student leadership program called Spirit. 14th is spring sports physicals. The 16th is parents meeting to discuss future considerations and redistricting. Please RSVP. The information is available on the website. The 20th, no school teacher in service. And already, kindergarten registration is scheduled for March 6th through the 10th. The Plum High School Musical, April 5th through the 8th. Don't forget to come and see it. Irving Berlin's White Christmas. That's it for tonight. Thank you all for coming. One last thing. The board will meet in executive session following this meeting.